Thank you for joining us at the Peace Action Forum. I'm Florindo. I'm a member of Peace Action Manhattan. And we have this meeting every month, usually 7 o'clock in this room on the first Thursday of the month. This month it's the second Thursday, so that we could accommodate our speakers. We have a Facebook page, Peace Action Manhattan, if you want to check month to month and see exactly when our meetings are. Generally, they're the first Thursday of the month. We have different speakers for all different kinds of issues. We're a peace group that emphasizes democracy and nonviolence. And we are particularly focused on the elimination of nuclear weapons. So we want to invite the public to all of our all of our events so that we can share our ideas. This group has come to talk with us about their experience in Syria. We have Madelyn, Hoffman, and Joe Jamison. And they traveled to Syria in August for a week. So I ask everybody to please respectfully listen. We're going to have a Q&A when the speakers are done. But meanwhile, I'd like to ask everybody to hold their questions and comments until the end.
If people want to know about our activities or future forums, we have a website and we have a phone number you can call.
And so before I get to that, we'll take a quick aside and welcome a visitor who is the new executive director of Peace Action National. His name is John Rainwater. He's from California, and he's visiting New York at the moment. I've asked him to come and say a few words before we start.
Thanks, Florindo. Thanks, everybody, for coming, and thank you for your activism in New York. It's very visible since you're in the center of the media world here, and so it's very important in terms of the peace work around the country. I just want to just take a couple of minutes to underline what Florindo said. A lot of the issues that we'll be working on, whoever is elected president, and some of the scenarios are a little inconceivable to know exactly what will happen over the next couple of years, but we'll be working on nuclear weapons issues. I think everybody here probably knows that the United States is planning to spend $1 trillion over the next 30 years to upgrade nuclear weapons capability, which obviously is in the reverse way we should be headed in terms of eliminating nuclear weapons from the world. We'll be working on that. We'll be working on moving military spending to human needs. We're spending as much as we ever spent during the Cold War, more than the next 8 countries combined. We'll be working on a lot of issues, including hopefully facilitating or pushing the United States to engage in the Middle East and Syria in a way that's diplomacy-oriented instead of military first. I think we can see that there are a lot of different opinions on Syria. I hope that there'll be future forums where we can hear other opinions. The National Office has perhaps a slightly different point of view than the folks speaking here today. But we are concerned that U.S. military intervention, when done under a humanitarian banner, doesn't always turn out the way that we hope. And I hope we can all agree on that, that if we look at Libya, this was sold as a certain type of no-fly zone intervention, and we wound up with something very different. And so I hope that people who care about human rights can come together and point out all human rights violations when they see it, no matter who the party is, because I think ultimately we as human beings want to protect human life and care about human life and should call out violations of rights wherever we see it. So those are some of the things we'll be working on over the next few years, but I just want to thank you for your activism, thank all of you, thank Peace Action of New York State for your great leadership, and really appreciate everybody being here and thinking about these issues and caring about what goes on beyond our doorsteps in New York or wherever. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Joe. Okay, there's going to be, the speakers are going to get about 20 minutes each. I'll keep time. Then we'll have a short break for announcements. And maybe if you need to run to the bathroom, get water, or a bite to eat, or something to drink. But then we want to come back for the Q&A at the end. So we ask you certainly not to leave, and we certainly need to also ask you for money. Sally, do you want to read the bios for us?
Oh, as they speak, Madelyn, you're going to speak first?
Yes.
Okay. So just to introduce you to Madelyn Hoffman, she's a longtime peace activist. And in addition to participating on the recent delegation to Syria, she has participated on peace missions to Japan, Afghanistan, Ukraine, Tunisia, the West Bank of Palestine, and Israel. So welcome, Madelyn Hoffman.
Thank you, Sally.
Yeah, so Madelyn, take it away.
Okay, I guess I should stand. Can you hear me in the back there? I tend to have a loud, I tend to be able to project, but if you can't hear me, let me know, and or just kind of do that, and I'll raise the volume. I'll up the volume. So this past summer, July 24th through July 30th, I had the opportunity to participate on a delegation that went to Syria, delegation that was organized by the U.S. Peace Council, and it was organized with the idea that it was a fact-finding delegation and also a delegation for peace. What we wanted to do by going was to find ways and discuss ways of ending the conflict that would be peaceful ones, that would put an end to the violence and create a situation where the violence would not continue to spiral out of control. So it was our belief and our hope that by going that we would have an opportunity to meet with and talk to many different kinds of people. And so when we planned the delegation on this side of the world, we talked to people in Syria and the permanent ambassador Syria's permanent ambassador to the UN, in order to create a delegation that was well-rounded, that would allow us to meet with many different kinds of people. So we met with members of parliament, we met with chambers of industry, we met with students, we met with faculty at the University of Damascus, we met with the Minister of Health, we met with the Minister of Reconciliation, we met with the nonviolent opposition in Syria, political opposition. We met with people who run community development centers, women who run the centers, women and men, for women who lost their husband, either they know their husband has been killed or their husband is missing. They come to the center to learn how to sew, to discuss relevant issues of the day. We went to an orphanage. This one was for girls only. About 400, 500 girls were there. Only eight are there on a regular basis. Since it was summer, there were only 8 permanent residents there, young women. And we had a chance to talk to them about what they think about what's going on in Syria today, what they think of the United States and the role of the United States. And we talked to the people who run the orphanage, and we found out, of course, well, not, I shouldn't say of course, but in retrospect, it's of course, that there is a far greater need for these orphanages than there actually is. And these aren't orphans in the sense that they have no mother or father. These are orphans because they have no father. The father was involved in something that was killed during the conflict that began in February of 2011. So we met with many other ministers in the government, and we also, at the end of our trip, we met with the president of Syria as well, Assad. I want to say up front that a lot of what we heard from all these different people, from some students as well, a lot of what we heard did not jive with what we've been told here in the United States through the Western media. There were a lot of things that were not the same. And So in that respect, I feel a tremendous responsibility to report back to you on what we heard, because it is different and distinct from what we hear every day. And I think we think that in order to reach a peaceful solution and to get something done in Syria, have something happen in Syria that will lead to peace for everyone in Syria, we need to know the different points of view and the different perspectives about what's happening there. And I also want to say up front, because as long as I've been an activist, I should have been expecting this, but I didn't. The propaganda war here in the United States is very vicious. And a lot of things that I say, even though they're not designed to be pro or anti-Assad, are construed as pro-Assad. And I want to say up front that everything I say is not intended to be an endorsement specifically of him or the Syrian government, but is a report back of what I saw. And only the Syrian people have the right to decide who their leadership is. And that's our position, and we stand by it. And unfortunately, as long as we are focused, the West is focused on the elected leader of Syria and Assad, we're not focused on what the United States is doing. We're not focused on U.S. foreign policy in the region. We're not focused on things that we as Americans can do something about. And so between Joe and me, we're going to talk about some of those things and hopefully provide for everyone here a different way of looking at what's going on in Syria from the mainstream media way, which is what we hear all the time. So first of all, and this goes into the category of U.S. foreign policy, under the U.N. Charter, Article 2, regime change is illegal. Foreign intervention for the purpose of removing a leader of a sovereign country is illegal. And so we start from there, upholding the United Nations Charter and principles of the United Nations. What we saw, and I gave you the long list, I think I probably, oh, I did leave out. We met with Catholic priests. We met with the Grand Mufti, so we met with religious leaders as well. So we tried to, like I said, to have as wide a range of meetings as possible. And what we found was that the Syrian people that we met with, the people we spoke to, and I gave you the list, are united in one thing. And they are united in the fact that Syria is a sovereign country and that Syria has a right to protect itself from outside foreign intervention. We had a trip to areas where there was an ancient Catholic shrine, holy shrine, where the people in the shrine, the priests still speak Aramaic. And then we went to a nearby village that was where there was a Catholic cathedral, a beautiful Catholic cathedral. And to a person, when we asked, the delegation kind of rolled their eyes at me when I asked the bishops, or the bishops, how many people in Syria are Christian and how many are Muslim, because I kind of knew what the answer was going to be at this point in the trip, so I wanted to hear that said back to me. And some of the people on the delegation were saying, why are you asking this question? But I asked, what percentage of the population is Christian? What percentage of the population is Muslim? And both the Grand Mufti and the Catholic bishop said, we don't look at ourselves that way. At this point, there are 23 million Syrians. And so if there are 23 million Syrians, there are 23 million Muslims, and there are 23 million Christians. And that's how we look at it. We don't want to be divided. We're not going to be divided. We are a united people. That also includes non-violent political opposition to the government of Assad. We talked to the Minister of Reconciliation, Ali Haider. We talked to some other people, one person who was a member of parliament, I believe he's still a member of parliament. and a member of the nonviolent opposition, and they said, yes, we have had disagreements with Assad. We had disagreements with Assad before 2011. Said, but once this started happening in our country, we felt the best chance to protect Syrian sovereignty was for us to unite with our government. And we'll put our political differences aside, but together, that's how we're going to protect our country from outside foreign intervention. And so this is where a number of the nonviolent opposition wound up and still active, and in fact, inside the government buildings and working with the Assad government. Maybe not, you know, when this is done, when the conflict is over and Syrians get a chance again to decide who their leadership is, who knows? But for now, they said this was their best option, was to work together with President Assad. Okay, so now another thing we learned when we talked to all these different people was the impact of sanctions. For one, I was embarrassed, but I did not realize that the United States and the EU and NATO had imposed sanctions on the Syrian people. And these are crippling sanctions. We all know that sanctions never really harm the leader of a country. They harm innocent people. We know what happened in Iraq and Madeleine Albright's infamous statement, about how even though 500,000 children were killed under sanctions, it was a price worth paying to unseat Saddam Hussein. We know that sanctions don't work in the way that they're designed. They hurt innocent people. So all these sectors of Syrian society have been harmed by the sanctions. And this is what we heard when we talked to the faculty and students at the University of Damascus, when we talked to the Minister of Health, when we talked to the Chambers of Industry, and when we talked to the Lawyer Syndicate, another group that we met with in Syria. In terms of education, there used to be a very healthy exchange of students between the United States and Syria. Syrian students studying in the United States, going back to Syria with what they learned, contributing to Syria with that education. The sanctions prohibit that. So there are people in Syrian students in the United States who aren't going back, and Syrian students in the University of Damascus who aren't coming here or anywhere in Europe. I mean, it's not just US Syria, it's US Europe. And they're not allowed to do that, which harms education for the Syrians. Interestingly enough, even if one university in Syria is damaged, the University of Damascus is accepting students from anywhere with open arms. Continue your education here because education is important in Syrian society. Healthcare, we were told that there were some shortages when we went, shortages of things like filters for dialysis machines. They're not allowed in under sanctions. Chemotherapy. Drugs are not allowed in under sanctions. And then the other child immunizations for children are not allowed in under sanctions. And some of the largest pharmaceutical companies, at least one while we were there, we heard an announcement that they had refused to send in immunizations. So that's harming the children of Syria. In terms of the chambers of industry, like our Chamber of Commerce here, men and women who own factories and other commercial establishments, for one, they can't get some of the materials, some of the equipment they need to run their factory. And for another, if they get the equipment, they can't get the person to come along with the equipment who's going to train them on how to use it. Now, why is this important? If the factory shuts down, where are the employees of that factory going to go? In the current climate there, with a lot of outside foreign mercenary groups that are employed in, you know, creating terror for some Syrian people, if somebody comes up to you and says, "You don't have a job, here's some money I can give you," people will go for where the money is, regardless of what the job is. And so these chambers, men and women in the chambers of industry were very upset at the impact of sanctions because it adds to some of the problems they face, because they cannot, I mean, they are trying everything they can to keep people employed in whatever, in their factories and so on. And lastly, in the legal profession, there are some of the lawyers in Syria were members of international legal associations, and these international legal associations, under the sanctions, have expelled the Syrian attorneys. Now, why is this important? Because if you value the international law and you value the fact that Article 2 of the UN Charter says regime change is illegal, if you're barred, if your attorneys are barred from an international legal association, it makes it a little bit harder for you to make that case. And so that's another way in which the sanctions are crippling or harming the Syrian people. And that's four different parts of the population. And there's others, but this is what we heard directly from the Syrian people. And I believe, I don't know how much time I have left.
Got about 3 minutes.
3 minutes, okay. I'm pretty much complete, except that, I talked about UN Charter sanctions and the unity of the Syrian people. I think I can stop there. I've kind of put everything together into a package there for you. I'll say one more thing, and that is that while we were there, we had a couple of people translating for us, one of whom was a headmistress at a school in Damascus. And she, when we got together towards the end, just before we were leaving, she said that some of her friends were kind of incredulous that she was spending so much time with a delegation from the United States, because they said, we don't think that these people are going to be able to do anything when they get back home, and the United States is not going to make any changes. Why are you spending so much time with people from the United States? And she said, because I believe in them. I believe they can do something. I think they want to do something. And so for all of us, when we left Damascus, when we left Syria, we felt a tremendous responsibility to do what we could to help the Syrian people. In Damascus, you'd walk in. I posted some photos the other day on Facebook of a marathon that took place in the middle of Damascus. People are going to school, people are working, people are having weddings, people are participating in marathons. You know, their life is going on. But for somebody who cares about peace in the world and doing something that will relieve the stress and the suffering of the Syrian people, that's how I felt when I left Syria, and that's why I'm making presentations such as this one. Thank you.
I've moved the pizza over. There are a few seats over here if anybody wants to sit down.
Yeah, there's also a seat on the front here. There's another seat here.
This is a seat here?
Okay. There's one here, two over there. Okay, Sally Jones is going to tell us about our next speaker.
Our next speaker is Joe Jamison. He's a member of the Executive Committee of the U.S. Peace Council, and he's coordinator for the Queens New York Peace Council that was reestablished in 2013. He's been an active member in different anti-war groups since the Vietnam War era. In 1970 to 1972, he was a conscientious objector to that war and performed alternative service as an emergency hospital worker. He has a labor movement background. In 2014, he retired from the staff of the New York State Labor Council, having served in such positions as research director and transportation union director. Before that, in 1987 to 1990, he was a staff journalist for the Transport Workers Union. So please welcome Joe Jamison.
I'll try to speak up if I, please indicate if I'm not projecting.
Joe, I would recommend you stand.
Should I stand up? Okay.
It helps project your voice.
Yeah, okay. You're good. Thank you. I'll jump around a bit and try to fill in some items that Madelyn did not discuss. I'll try to stay close to what we saw and heard and concluded in Syria. First of all, it's an honor for me to speak at Peace Action New York, Peace Action Manhattan. I'm a big fan of Peace Action, the giant rally that you and your predecessor organizations organized June 12, 1982, I remember it so well. It was a high point of my life, and Peace Action played an enormous role in that. And I should point out that Peace Action on Syria has excellent positions. I checked. Let me just point out what they are. Stop the bombing and military escalation, hit ISIS where it hurts, namely in the wallet, the oil money, and so forth, build a coalition for a political solution, support a United Nations-led effort to convene Iraq, Egypt, Turkey, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, Iran, European Union, and Russia to develop a strong diplomatic, economic, and political initiative to restrict the flow of arms, militias, and finances across borders, support restarting UN-sponsored negotiations to end the Syrian civil war. So those are excellent positions, I think, and I fully support them. A lot of anti-war, because the situation is so fluid, I'll get to this in a bit, a lot of organizations are updating their positions, and we certainly are at the U.S. Peace Council. So what I'll try to do is go through a couple of major conclusions we had, and try to explain them. And I'll try to deconstruct some of the myths, what we view as myths, about the war in Syria. The war in Syria is not a civil war. The war in Syria is an external aggression financed by some regional powers like Saudi Arabia and Qatar, and backed up by the United States and NATO, and the European Union. In America, we have to think, the model that is really the most appropriate to understand the Syria war is the war against, the war of the Contras, against Nicaragua. It was an external war financed by the United States, organized by the United States. You all remember, perhaps those of us of a certain age remember that Ollie North was finagling in the basement of the White House, earning money off Iran, sales of weapons to Iran, and using that money to pay for the incursion of the Contras. That's the kind of war this is. How is this possible? What is a civil war? A civil war exists when large segments of society have such acute clashes that the conflict between them turns into an armed struggle. That's a civil war. It happened in our country. It happened in many countries. You don't have that in Syria. Madelyn alluded to it. There is a high degree of unity among all the forces in Syrian society against this external, in fact, the external aggression. In fact, the unity has gotten more intense since the war began. And that is a factor that we don't hear in the United States, and it's a key to understanding a lot of what is going on. We also learned, and this will go down hard with some, that the demonization of the Syrian president and his government is also false. The Syrian government is popular. That will go down hard with a lot of people who are dogmatically convinced he's a monster, he's a madman, he's a butcher, all of that. And there are people on the left and on the right who hold that view. The Syrian government is popular. The Syrian president runs a government of national unity. Some of his party opponents, the man who ran against them in the last set of elections, is now in his government negotiating with the mercenaries to try to get them to surrender in an amnesty program. Some of his party opponents disagree with him. Some on the right disagree with him about the degree of secularity in the state. The Islam practiced in Syria is an inclusive and pluralistic kind of Islam, unlike the kind of Islam you see in Saudi Arabia and Qatar. Some of his opponents and critics are on the left, and they would be critical of the corruption that has existed in Syria. They'd be critical of the degree of repression used, for example. They would be disagree with some of the neoliberal policies that he has made concessions to. As Madelyn pointed out, there still is a large healthcare sector, education sector, state sector, but there have been concessions to the pressure of the IMF and the World Bank and these world financial institutions. But as she pointed out, even his opponents, the legitimate democratic opposition, the people who got blown off the streets in 2011 when these jihadi forces hijacked the democratic movement in the streets, they recognize that he is the elected national leader at a time of invasion and crisis, and therefore he has to be supported. It's critical support, but nevertheless it is support. We also learned that the U.S. is not fighting a war against ISIS. Don't most Americans have the impression this is a war against ISIS? The U.S. is not really fighting an all-out war against ISIS. The main aim of U.S. policy is regime change by means of selective support for various terrorist mercenary groups. It is not fighting terrorism. The U.S. coddles such groups as al-Nusra, which fights the Syrian government. I should talk a bit about the nature of these jihadist groups, or foreign fighters, or mercenaries, or whatever you wish to call them. They go by a lot of descriptions. There is very little discussion in the narrative that you and I hear every day in the mainstream media about the nature of the U.S. allies and the proxies, its proxies in the region. And the two of the most important are the Wahhabism, which is the form of Islam that dominates the Saudi state, which is particularly reactionary and primitive and backward. And also the Muslim Brotherhood. It's not quite as bad as Wahhabism, but nevertheless also plays a reactionary role. If the Syrian government were to fall, these dark, ugly forces would be what replaces them. And so my view is that those who adopt the Assad must go slogan, whether they are on the right or the left or in the center, need to be challenged. That's the objective consequence of that position. It would be sickening. I could repeat in detail what various journalists told me about what the Wahhabist mercenaries do to women when they have been captured. But I'll spare you that. But the words that come to me are sick, barbaric, monstrous, heinous. And they're the adjectives that come to mind. We have to have a better understanding of Wahhabism because it's an international force. The Saudis have deep pockets. And they promote and fund this backward and sectarian version of Islam all over the world. This Wahhabism abhors a secular state. The Syrian Arab Republic is the only remaining independent secular Arab state in the region. And its government, as I said, is a multi-party one. Damascus promotes this socially inclusive, pluralist version of Islam. And the leaders of the political party say to a person that secularism, secularity, is the future of the region. So that's what's at stake. Two different, this is a conflict between various religious visions that are lined up on one side or another. And for us as Americans who presumably have a secular and democratic view of the world, that's what's at stake. It is very hard to keep up to speed on all these groups, al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, ISIS, all the rest. They're kind of shape-shifting. They change their names. I saw al-Nusra the other day decided to call itself the Conquest Front. Which they ought to hire a new PR firm. I don't think that name is really going to get them very far, but nevertheless, that's what goes on. But their social nature is the same. The Saudis run very skillfully and a very expensive project of social media. And that is how they do this recruitment. There are about 80,000, maybe 100,000 mercenaries. Through social media, they reach into communities in the slums of London, the slums of Paris, the slums of New York, Toronto, you name it. And they reach Islamic youth who are oppressed,
and who are have no job prospects, who get all the discrimination that Western societies impose on them, and they tell them, come to Turkey, and you have a different future. You have a glorious future fighting for the faith. And a lot of them, sadly, fall for that. The vast majority of the mercenaries are foreign fighters. We were told that the head of ISIS in Syria comes from Norway. Some of these people are second-generation Islamic youth in European US and Canada. So there is a small number of Syrians who have joined the jihadists, but and this shows you how counterproductive the sanctions policy is. Madelyn implied it. When there's mass unemployment, and there is rising unemployment in Syria thanks to the bite of the sanctions, you can earn 10 times what a Syrian soldier would earn if you join the mercenaries. So, you mentioned the EU and the US sanctions. Let me talk about the way, not what we learned, but what we learned since. Everything has gotten worse. The crisis in Syria has gotten worse. The carnage is worse. That's point number one. Point number two, and so the humanitarian crisis is just as bad. We're talking 400,000 dead, 5 million refugees in a country of 21 million people. Half of the people have had to move, mostly to eastern Syria, where our government secured areas, fleeing the jihadi areas. By the way, that's a very important indirect indicator of what who is popular and who is not popular. So you have that awful humanitarian crisis, which is getting worse, and it's being used by pro-war factions in this country to demand escalation of the war. In our view, ending every aspect of U.S. intervention is the solution. But there are two other crises that are overlapping, and that is the American presidential election. I won't make any party political comments about the two leading candidates, but I think it's pretty much universally agreed that after January, we face a more hawkish government in Washington. That creates a crisis for us in the anti-war movement. And the final thing, and this may be of special interest to Peace Action, in my view, Peace Action has been maybe the leading voice of the US people in terms of the nuclear danger. And a new wrinkle in the Syrian crisis, the Syrian war, is that two nuclear-armed states are head-to-head and toe-to-toe. You just have to read the newspapers over the last week, and you see Russian generals and American generals pounding their chests, eager for some kind of confrontation. And the possibilities of an accident are enormous. Both sides are arming, putting in anti-aircraft missiles. You have loose talk on the part of John McCain and Hillary Clinton and others about a no-fly zone. People don't even understand what a no-fly zone is. A no-fly zone means air war with the Russian and Syrian army. And the Russian army and air force, I should say, the Russian forces have nuclear weapons. How can people with any degree of responsibility talk so lightly about that? And so I'm making this appeal to Peace Action that perhaps it's a way into this issue that's quite natural, and where you have already displayed remarkable leadership and consistency.
1 minute.
So we think that the Syrian crisis is deepening. We think that it's time for the U.S. anti-war movement to get together and ramp up our opposition to this war. In our view, opposition to the root cause of the war, the U.S. policy of regime change, would be the most effective. But all of us should strengthen our positions and increase our activity, because there may be hell to pay after January. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much to our speakers and our very attentive audience. Before we go to the Q&A, there is a plastic container on the back table. Can we please pass that around and ask everybody to put in their 25 cents or $20 or whatever it is you're going to put in? please. And you might want to, if you have to go to the restroom, it's like on the other side of that wall. You have to go around that way. We're going to resume with the question and answer in about 2 minutes. But
are you able to accept credit cards tonight?
I have an announcement.
We have announcements to make. I'm not sure. I think I am. So, Sally, do you have an announcement?
Yes, I do. There's a, I don't know if I have enough flyers, but I have, maybe I do. Could you please pass out these flyers? It's for an event that's coming up on Monday, October 24th at All Souls Church. All Souls is located at Lexington Avenue and between 79th and 80th Street. William Perry, who's the former Secretary of Defense underneath the Clinton administration, has written a book called My Journey at the Nuclear Brink, and he is going to be talking about his experience and his mission right now towards nuclear abolition. He's about 88, 89 years old, and he has made it his his last project. He's spent a lot of time on trying to get the U.S. policy changed on nuclear weapons. And he speaks from a very authoritative experience. It's very interesting to read the book. I read it. I've never read anything from the point of view of an insider in the nuclear weapons business, not only in government but in private industry, and it's very illuminating to see that point of view. And now that he is hopefully on our side pushing for nuclear abolition, it may be a very interesting talk, and I invite you all. It's 7 o'clock, All Souls Unitarian Church, so please come.
These are some profound issues we need to ask about. We're particularly interested in hearing about other proposals for anti-war activities regarding Syria here. So let me invite everybody with questions to address them to our speakers.
Okay. Starting now?
Yes,
I think
she had her hand up.
Yeah, go ahead. Hi, my name is Susan Smith, and I'm with the Stony Florindo.
Yeah, hi, Susan.
Hi, nice to see you again. So, Stony Point Center and Muslim Peace Fellowship, hi Joe. We were so happy to co-sponsor with Peace Action New Jersey, and all of you came to our multi-faith anti-drone conference earlier this year. We very much are anti-imperialism, anti-militarism, 100%. On that note, though, I'd like to now introduce Ahed Festuk. She is a asylee, a politicalized asylee from Aleppo. She's 28 years old, and she fled the Assad regime. She is absolutely traumatized by this discussion and the content of this discussion, and I ask that we treat her gently, but she wants to pose a different point of view.
Let's try to keep it to a minute.
Yeah, it's not the question. I wish you had a good trip in our country. I don't know which party you go. Like, you go just for Assad regime, or you go to see what is going on really. Did you see the school when the Assad bombed? Did you see the hospital? Okay, I will tell you. You said you talk with everybody.
No.
Okay. You said you talk with the student, with the journalist, with the blah blah blah. I don't care with who you talk, but you talk with just the people support Assad regime, and you try to support him. I don't know why, but you didn't see anything. You see just what you want to see. You didn't see anything.
Do you have a question?
It's not a question. And we are not civil war. We are not war. We are revolution. We have in Syria revolution against Bashar al-Assad, against ISIS, against Al-Qaeda, against Russia. against everybody coming from outside Syria to invade in our ground. This is what is going on in Syria.
You never went to opposition side, only you went to regime side.
Yes, she said that.
Yes.
And it was 20, excuse me, it was 23 million people, but now only 10 million people. You know that?
Yes, she said it's half. Can we respond or is it?
Yes, sure. Okay, we're taking turns here. Plenty of time.
Well, maybe there was no question, so maybe we should hear a few more before we respond.
Yes, not the question, because I don't want to listen answer, because I know what is going on. I came here just 10 months ago. I know what is going on there.
Okay, thank you.
We going there, we see what happened over there, and only you see the regime side. No, they never take you the opposition side.
This I need to respond to.
Only you went.
It's not. That is
they
not
never
true.
Let you go to Arab side.
Excuse me. Yes, I do. I speak some Arabic. I've been studying Arabic. Yes, but that doesn't mean I understood everything that I was.
Who was the translator?
There were different translators. But here, please. I just want to respond simply to a couple of things. One is, obviously, the reason we went there is because we are very concerned about all the civilian casualties. We're all deep. We're deeply concerned about all the civilian casualties, and we wanted to find out how and why and what so that we could offer suggestions for ways to reduce, eliminate, and end civilian casualties. So that's one. When we set this up, we said it earlier, and I'll say it again. We met with non-violent opposition people. We did. Now, there's one more question on this, because it's become, unfortunately, the lines in Syria have become very blurred in terms of who is the genuine homegrown Syrian opposition and who are the opposition that's been taken, that's armed opposition, that's fueled by the outside. And right. So when we talk about opposition and revolution and unseating Assad, two things. One is, yes, the Syrian people need to decide that. But at this point, when we look at what's going on there, and we hear about al-Nusra, and we have had journalists go to those places after we left, we didn't go into Aleppo ourselves. We didn't want a.
We weren't allowed.
Yep, the security
exactly.
risk.
But
we talked to people. We talked to people who were doing their own food aid drops. We talked to people who understand the situation. And I'll just add, because I know you all have questions. The problem is determining who is the real homegrown Syrian opposition and separating them from the outside foreign mercenary forces who are not homegrown and have regime change in the back as their agenda. So
okay, there's a lot of questions. I'm going to put a stack. We'll go right from the front here. What's your name?
Dave
and Alex. And then you had your hand up earlier. Shirley and...
Amina.
Oh, Amina, yeah, sure. And anybody else?
Sophia.
Okay, so we'll try and keep it orderly. We're a lot of people in a small room.
Rhonda.
Yusuf. Okay.
Put Joe on also?
We're going to be here today.
Yeah.
It's going to be a long
day. I don't know if we should respond to each.
Okay.
We're going to do a minute, and then
well, everybody's going to get like a minute and a half. Okay,
and then
so we're starting off with.
I thought you were going to have a break.
Dave, we had the break. They can answer anything anybody wants to ask them.
I wanted to repeat one thing. What's your name?
Joe
said. It's very crucial in this discussion, I believe. Who is the military force in the opposition? The military force, the most effective fighters, is al-Nusra. That is an absolute certainty. And let me tell you,
It's a free army. It's the free army.
It is al-Nusra. And if Assad falls, that black flag will fly over Damascus. I'm telling you, is this what you want? You say, no, man, this isn't going to happen. Some democratic force is going to happen instead. There's one country I want you to remember, Libya.
Right.
They had the no-fly zone in Libya. And people like you were screaming that their genocide here is massacres. Afterward, we found out that there weren't any. But the people who wanted that no-fly zone had regime change, and that's what will happen in Damascus.
Okay, is there a question?
I can take one.
Now we're at the end of it. I got everybody on stack.
When I came here, I was sure.
From, where?
From Upper West Side. I'm a
member.
I am a member of Peace Action Manhattan. I'm originally from Russia. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm joking. It was a joke. When I came to this meeting, I was sure there would be opposite positions. And I thought the temperature of discussion will be even higher. But without, and the list of participants in conflict runs pretty big. So would not it be a stronger position for peace action organizations to say, no external intervention, not only to stop American participation, but to stop Russian participation, Iranian, Saudi Arabia, whatever. The list goes pretty long. Would this position integrate much wider support?
I think you guys touched on that, but do you want to answer that?
Thank you. It has a certain plausibility to treat all the external forces equally. There are some factual issues here. One of them is that there are, if we believe in the sovereignty of the Syrian people, then the Syrian government has the right to to be involved, any ally it wants. That's number one. Let me finish. The other point is that I have certainly an analysis of what is the cause of this war. The cause of this war is the U.S. policy of regime change.
Right.
It's not the democratic deficiencies of the Syrian government. It's not even the regional players. None of them would be in this war to the extent that they are if it were not for the green light that the overarching power, the power that has 800 military bases around the world, a budget that's triple any remotely competitive military power, that power, the U.S., our government, is the cause of this war. And that's an analysis you really have to have in order to come up with a sensible policy. Now, I am pro-diplomacy, and I am pro-getting... We want a situation where Syria is free of foreign armies, but I think we have
All foreign armies.
So that's a laudable goal.
Absolutely.
And you're right to advance that. But there are some other intermediate issues that have to be dealt with, and one of them is the sovereignty of the Syrian people and their elected government to pick whoever they want as their allies. So I just offer that as a caveat to your otherwise totally plausible and sensible proposition.
Do you have anything on that, Madelyn?
No, Joe said it all.
Okay.
I mean, except the one thing is that some analysis have shown that if at this point Russia, you know, Article 52 that allows Russia and Iran to be invited in to assist in protecting the sovereignty of the Syrian state. If those armies,
and people,
yeah, and people. Well, that's what I mean. That's what I mean. Okay, people, sovereignty of the Syrian people. I will say that every time then, but that's because that's what I mean. If the Russian and Iranian forces were to leave now, there would be a power vacuum, and that would mean that the Assad government would be defeated. So, I mean, that it's it is And that's part of the plan. So I think that's what Joe was getting to, that until there's a political and diplomatic solution that needs to be reached as equal partners in this, and then but the ultimate resolution is for all of the foreign powers to be gone. That's absolutely true. But if it's done too soon, it might be destructive. That's all.
Who is Shirley?
She's my left.
Oh, okay. Johanna?
Oh, Madelyn, when you said you met with these various groups, you stressed several times the chambers of industry and how they are deprived of the material and they cannot do the factories. Right. And you compared it to the Chamber of Commerce in the USA. What I understand is it's not a laudable thing, the Chamber of Commerce.
Oh, well. Okay, maybe bad choice.
And seems to me, yes, these groups and another group, I didn't write, couldn't write fast enough, but they are already working together with the government. So it's easy to say, yes, they are pro-government and they see, and you see through them what good can come from the government. So what groups, powerful groups, if there are, did you talk to and see that are comparable to those as like oppositions to the government?
Well, I mean, we couldn't meet with any of the violent opposition, and we wouldn't meet with the violent opposition. Mm-hmm. We met with as many of the, with a selection, a sampling of the political opposition. And we met, I didn't mention this, I don't think, we met with members of parliament. And the parliament is, it's like 50% Assad's party, the Ba'ath party, a little bit more than 50. And then the rest is a whole mixture of a lot of different political parties. Mm-hmm. So we didn't, we were there for 5 days, there for 6 days, so we couldn't meet with each person in parliament representing a different point of view. But we did meet with some who, you know, who explained the position that they explained. Now, I mean,
that's
only so much you can do in 5 or 6 days.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We have another question.
You.
Amina?
Yes, hi. We know there are Russian military forces, Iranian military forces, Hezbollah units, Shiite militias from Iraq and elsewhere back in the Assad government. A recent Guardian report on the 6,000 pro-Assad fighters mobilizing for a ground attack on Aleppo identified hundreds of Syrian troops, but an estimated 5,000 foreign fighters recruited from Iraq, Iran, Lebanon, and Afghanistan. What did Assad say when you asked him why, when he supposedly has the support of the entire Syrian population, he has been unable to muster Syrian troops to fight on his behalf?
I think you've made up your mind already about that, but I will try to answer it. As I said, there are people in Syria, small number of people, who have joined the jihadis. But native Syrians, but the vast majority of the jihadis.
I don't speak for jihadis, nor do I support jihadis.
I'm glad to hear that. But the foreign
and
mercenaries.
Excuse me, I didn't.
Wait, let him answer the question, Amina.
Foreign mercenaries are overwhelmingly recruited from around the world, and even their leaders are recruited from around the world. There is a small group of Syrians that are part of that. Madelyn and our lawyer friend from New Jersey, who's a human rights lawyer and a Palestinian activist, who knows a lot about restorative justice, they asked one of the opposition leaders, Ali Haider, we mentioned him before, about how he handles the negotiations to obtain the laying down of arms by the foreign mercenaries. The policies for native Syrians when they are in the mercenary army, and the foreign fighters is different. they try to extradite the captured foreign fighters. They try to rehabilitate the native Syrians. I'm told the policy is 70% effective. That was the number that was cited when we spoke to the Bar Association and the staff people at the in the reconciliation. To my way of thinking, I've read a lot about civil wars, the U.S. Civil War. This is an extraordinary, humane, and sensitive, and reunifying policy for a government under siege to be adopting. Who knows about it in America? So I just urge you, those of you who have already made up your minds and just came here to annoy us,
try to down, 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 down.
Try, you're wait, annoyed.
Try
so
to
you're annoyed
do,
because
do,
we're concerned
do,
about
all right,
do your reading
for your concern.
I came here to listen, not to hear you.
Yeah, thank you for your concern.
Let me add something. May I add something to that?
Yeah.
For window. The other thing is, think about this. This started in February of 2011. Okay, it is now October 2016. It's 5 years. It's 5 years of crippling sanctions. It's 5 years of outside foreign forces. It's 5 years of a lot of attacks on the sovereignty of the Syrian people. And so, if you think back to Libya, when the United States said it's time for Libya to go, he felt like that. In Iraq, when it was time for Saddam Hussein, now there were years of sanctions and two wars before this, but when it was time for Saddam Hussein to go, he fell within 3 weeks. So much so that one of the reporters who had been asking me why there was opposition to the Iraq war before it started, after the statue of Hussein fell in the square and there was cheering, he said, "Does that change your view? Now are you in favor of the war?" So it was that quick, and people's minds changed. I said, no, I was still opposed to the war because of that. So, and you're asking about why Syria can't defend itself and doesn't have the support of the Syrian people 5 years later, 5.5 years later, almost 6 years later. That's why. It's been a long siege, and it's with crippling sanctions and a lot of outside pressure. And it was only recently that Russia and Iran were asked in to help to bolster the government. So, I mean, there's two different ways to look at this. There's different ways to look at it. Okay, and this is the other point of view I want to put out there.
Thanks. Sophia? Sophia.
He's a stack.
He's a stack. You got to wait. Sophia?
In your discussion, you've never mentioned refugees, and my question is, to prove you haven't cherry-picked this fact-finding mission, because on the one hand, you don't talk about over 4 million Syrian refugees, and it could be very well easy for you to interview people who actually did flee from Aleppo, from other places. In fact, there was a survey and a study that was done by one of the most respected German research institutes called the Berlin Social Science Center, of over almost 900 Syrians, refugees, and the vast, vast majority of the refugees, over 75% in many cases, said the reason why they fled explicitly was because they were fleeing Assad. By a smaller margin, it was the Nusra Front and ISIS, but on the vast, vast majority were fleeing arrests and disappearances by Assad, were fearing military conscription, and I'm a proud anti-war activist, and I know immediately that there's a reason why some of these soldiers fear killing their brothers and sisters and would rather run away, and I think it's a complete disservice to any genuine anti-war movement to say, to fiddle with those facts. In fact, I don't think you actually answered Amina's question. Her question was about why the Syrian army brings in their own mercenaries with their own flags. People are talking about black flags of ISIS. There's Hezbollah flags outside of Aleppo. There are sectarian chants that are Shia, that are anti-Sunni, that have also been injected into this. And as a principled anti-war activist, you should say all foreign intervention should be out. That includes Russia and Iran. At this point.
And the question is...
Yeah, my question is, how can you prove that you did not... You actually decided to represent the unity of the Syrian nation when millions of people are outside Syria itself and could very well tell you the reason why they fled was because of Assad and there was a revolution. And the current reasons for the conditions of this conflict was because Assad militarized and destroyed the popular demonstrations in 2011. And these are all facts I'd be happy to send to everyone here. And I think that's the basis for a real anti-war movement.
It's they said they were there for
he used
weeks.
The chemical weapon, he used the gas, he used...
Okay. Sorry,
my
now the next one is, thank you, Ron, Rhonda?
Yeah, I want to thank you for coming to give the talks, and I thought that you said a couple of important things that I would appreciate a little bit more discussion about. And one of them is, the issue of secular, that there was Iraq, there was Libya, and now there's left Syria, and that's a secular, and that you said that was said to be a significant issue. I think that is a significant issue, and it is interesting that Iraq and Libya were two others, and there was a secular movement in that region, which has essentially been attacked very seriously. So maybe you can clarify a bit. And the other question, I wanted to hear a little bit more about what that you talked about with Assad. I think it seems very important that he met with you, and a little bit of the understanding, because I think there's a, in this country, there are many, many very valuable articles and things being written, but essentially they're not the mainstream. And so I wondered if he knows about that, that there's a great deal of support up on the internet, of an internet media that's very important. And I guess the other question is...
Well, let's try to stick to one question.
And the other piece of this is there's a real lack of something in the U.S. that really does stand up and take up these issues in a way that gives a side different from the mainstream media. And do you see any movement towards having something that doesn't just critique the mainstream media, but gives some real understanding of what's happening?
Thank you. Who wants to respond to that?
Well, there were three or four questions in there, but let me just take one I know about, and that is the question of religion and secularism versus more conservative forms of Islam. It is very evident on the streets of Damascus that women in Syria have a very substantial amount of equality. They own cars. They have bank accounts. They vote. They have position. The head of the parliament is a woman. They have many representatives in parliament. They're active in politics. So, without abandoning the enlightened and progressive elements of Islam, and there are many elements of Islam, they're quite enlightened and progressive and humane and democratic. Without abandoning any of that, the Syrian government's policy has been to uplift women. Now, compare that to the ideology of the foreign mercenaries and their Saudi paymasters.
Right.
We are talking about beheadings. We are talking about women who can't, who have no rights, who are virtually property of their husbands. We are talking, this is the choice facing the Syrian people. This is the actual choice, not this imaginary revolution
choice.
That's the actual choice facing the Syrian people. And there's a fantasy land that some elements of the US left have about some revolution or something. And it isn't real, and it's going nowhere. Now, there has been a long time an element, what I would call the pro-war left. It manages, let me just lose my temper in a measured way.
I'm trying to keep him under
in a measured way, because I am
just
so tired of
a lot of people.
I am so tired of the baloney. There's a section of the U.S. left that manages to come up with left-wing reasons for supporting empire.
Right.
Or supporting reaction.
Exactly.
They've been doing it for ages. They've been doing it since August 1914.
Name somebody.
It goes on now. We've heard the voices in this room. It's about time it stopped. It's about time we had an honest approach to a vicious imperialist war waged by our government against the Syrian people. That's the truth. If you can't handle it, leave.
Yeah, I want to address another part of that question, and the question about movement in the United States to try to do something in a pro-peace kind of way, because despite the disagreements and despite the hostilities, some of which we've seen tonight, there's a real strong reason for us all to unite around this and to find a way to unite around all this, because otherwise nobody's going to be happy and the violence will continue out of control. And as Joe had said earlier on, I mean, there's a possibility of World War III and a nuclear confrontation with World War III. And it's not just Russia and the United States. There's France. There's other countries that are involved here. And so this is what I want to, in part, the reason for the delegation was to try to jumpstart what we're doing here in the United States in a way of having these very conversations about who's to blame, what's the problem, and then sifting through all of it, trying to find that common ground that we all have. We're not going to solve this problem by talking at one another like this. We have to find common ground. And so, in terms of common ground, is there a military solution to this conflict? I don't think so. And I promote there is no military solution. It's got to be a political solution. Okay, that's one. Foreign intervention, as Joe said in response to you, there's agreement that the foreign intervention eventually, all of it has got to go. But there are concerns of, in terms of that political, having a political agreement in place before everybody goes, so that everybody's negotiating from a position of strength or relative strength. You know, the negotiations for ceasefire and other ends to the conflict, the Saudi Arabian government was insisting that al-Nusra and ISIS be at the table. Now, would we, is that, no.
What a liar.
I'm sorry, I'm not a liar. Yes. I'm not a liar.
ISIS
I'm sorry. Anyway.
ISIS
no, they,
at the table?
This, come on, this, sorry. I guess the idea of dialogue is, I'm trying to dialogue here. If you disagree with me, that's fine.
Okay.
No, I'm sorry.
You don't have to listen.
My goodness. No, but I think if we're going to have a political solution, I'll just say it this way then. Based on what regardless of what we saw and heard, if there's going to be a solution to this conflict, it's not going to be negotiated with ISIS or al-Qaeda or al-Nusra. They cannot be at the table because they are not there organically. They've been pushed, they've been sent there. So just like there was no al-Qaeda in Iraq before the United States invaded, there was no ISIS in Iraq until the United States invaded. Do you think the solution involves sitting down in Iraq, involves sitting down with ISIS?
Nobody's
I don't.
Advocating.
I don't know, but please, I didn't mean you specifically. I used the you generally. I'm sorry.
Keep it down in the back.
Was a war.
Keep it down, please.
Nothing to do with Syria. Iraq was different thing.
Just let me finish here, that I think there are ways in which we can all unite around finding a political solution and preventing World War III and a nuclear confrontation. And that's what I'm here to talk about. And that's why I think, that's why I accepted the invitation to go on the delegation, because I thought this kind of dialogue needed to happen. And so I'm glad to have been part of this. Thank you.
This is the one thing we've got going for us, really, as I see it. I mean, we're all making the future together. Whatever it's going to be the future we make. So we have to find a way to do this, whether we want to or not. So let's make it work. Sarah?
First of all, I wanted to really thank Peace Action and the Peace Council, Peace Action hosting this meeting, and the fact that this delegation went. I traveled to Syria twice in delegations, and I just want to say there are people in this room, and it's unfortunate because you're discrediting yourself by ending up on the same side as Saudi Arabia, as Israeli intervention, and especially U.S. imperialism. I mean, there are two sides in this struggle, and also being on the same side as al-Nusra. No matter how you oppose it, there are sides.
That's so racist.
And you're not going to interrupt.
You're racist.
Do not interrupt me.
You're racist.
You can't
no,
like
not
that.
At all.
You're racist.
You got to wait until you're called on to talk. Thank you. She's been waiting. Go ahead.
Thank you. There's a real U.S. agenda here. They state it again and again and again, which is regime change. That means a total collapse of the government. Not just Assad, one person. They mean a complete pulling down and disintegration of Syria, such as they carried out in Libya and in Iraq. That is U.S. policy. And they state it again and again, and they are very clear about even the forces they'll use. Hillary Clinton and the debates, what's their mm-hmm. solution? Let's push ISIS from Iraq into Syria. They're not alone in the way in which they're using ISIS. So I'm both thanking, but I do want to ask my question really, is if you would say a little bit more on U.S. policy in Syria pre-2011. Because the sanctions in Syria began in 2003, at the time of the invasion of Iraq. And the sanctions were brutal, because more than 3 million Iraqis sought refuge in Syria. It created great scarcity, and at the same time, Syria couldn't actually get the very supplies that they needed. So both the sanctions beginning in 2003, and then Ambassador Ford, who went to Syria very openly, and this has been described again and again, through WikiLeaks and through a lot of other, to organize and help to fund and coordinate with opposition groups with the aim of pulling down the Syrian government. That was so connected with what was being done. Syria was part of what Bush called the Axis of Evil, and they listed Iraq and Syria and Libya, Iran, that is their policy. So if you'd say a little bit more about the earlier efforts to the sanctions beginning in 2003, especially, 13 years ago.
Yeah, thank you for raising that, Sarah. Because it's important. The U.S. hostility to an independent Syrian state goes way back. The Syrian state has been the thorn in the side of U.S. policy in the Middle East for more than a generation, because Syria has shown a relatively independent policy. It has challenged the role of Israel on a number of occasions, and there have been military clashes. It has pursued alliances that the U.S. oil companies and the U.S. State Department do not like. So it has, the hostility is longstanding. Now it's being, why did a war arise in 2011? I refer you to, many books, on Syria. But the one that I think is the finest book by far is a book by an Australian academic named Tim Anderson. And it's available from Global Research, and it's exhaustive about the history of Syria's foreign policy and its international relations. And it's sober and it's balanced. And I urge you to read that to get some of the history, including the history about 2011. 2011 was the year of the Arab Spring, and there was a democratic upsurge in many countries, but that upsurge was hijacked by forces such as Israel, such as the United States, such as Saudi Arabia, and taken over, literally taken over in the streets of Deraa, where all of a sudden men with machine guns, paid for by Saudi Arabia, are shooting when there had been a peaceful demonstration and this went on. And if this seems outlandish, I just call your attention to the facts of Ukraine in the recent period, where similarly, a democratic opposition in the town, in the main square in Kiev, was hijacked. There's a political technology out there that the U.S. has mastered, and now it's being used selectively in various countries around the world, where it wants to overthrow the government for whatever reason. Largely, it's a government that pursues an independent policy. That's the issue now. In the old days, pre-1989, 91, it was communist, Marxist, leftist, nationalist. Now it's brutal dictator, violator of human rights, violator of women's rights. The demonization goes on. They've evolved. This would require a separate discussion. The demonization goes on. And just last point, they have new. The soft power learns. The soft power takes new forms. The use of the NGOs, for example, the White Helmets, the Doctors Without Borders, the Syrian Observatory of Human Rights. There's a vast infrastructure of NGOs pumping out this line that U.S. intervention is the way to solve the problems of Syria. We have to be realistic about this and start telling the truth. And unfortunately, not everybody wants to hear it.
Well, it takes time. Joe.
I just think it's pretty amazing that we're standing here in the United States and there are people in this room who consider themselves progressive and leftists and peace activists. They're attacking Assad, not the United States. You know, it's like we don't learn certain things. I remember way back in the beginning of the Gulf War when this woman went in front of Congress and talked about how they took the babies, the Iraqi soldiers, out of the incubators and threw them on the floor. Now, she was the daughter of the ambassador. She wasn't even in Kuwait when she said this happened, which it never happened. Did not the American government know who she was when she did that? Of course they knew. They lie and they lie again. They always lie. And why do you accept that propaganda when we are over there bombing? We are a country that has 20 times the number of foreign military bases as all other countries in the world combined. And you, American activists, are over here shouting down people who went to Syria to see what was happening, to bring back and have a discussion. And instead you shout over them rather than listening and have a dialogue. Now, the fact that there's an increase in propaganda means one thing. Because historically, you can look and see it. It means they're getting ready for war. And the propaganda that you're shouting and won't even let me talk now, you've talked so many times already, the propaganda you're shouting builds the case for war. That's not the role the anti-war movement in the United States should be doing. So let's stop it. Let's find unity. Let's say, get the United States out and let the Syrian people decide themselves. And when they do, you will see the massive numbers of people like you saw during the elections that took place in 2012 that came out. The United States has been there for 5 years. The thousands, tens of thousands of jihadists in this small country have been there for 5 years. Russia's been there for one. And you're complaining about Russia and not the United States, your own country? Where's your head?
Do you have a question for you?
No.
Yes.
Okay, Matt.
Okay. My name is Matt from a group called the League for the Revolutionary Party. I think that the United States.
Can you speak up?
I think that the United States is the world's greatest terrorist power. I think the U.S. imperialism is the bloodiest empire in human history. But I also think that U.S. imperialism is not the only imperialist in the world. And so I have a few questions. One speaker said, described how Syrian hospitals, because of U.S. sanctions, are missing dialysis machines and chemotherapy and so forth, sanctions of the type which I'm against. Syria is also missing 59 hospitals that were bombed by Russia. Why did you not mention those? Why should people not think that your failure to mention that is a deliberate attempt to mislead people? On the other speaker, questions for the other speaker. He mentioned peaceful protests at the beginning against the Assad regime that were then blown away by jihadists, Al-Qaeda and so forth, yes? Now, as silly as I think it is, to ignore the Assad regime's violent attacks on such demonstrations, which are easily Googleable and watchable on YouTube, do you recognize that the United States, in terms of U.S. imperialism, was cooperating with Assad in the extradition program of jihadists, and that the leaders of Al-Qaeda in Syria, the leaders of Ahrar al-Sham and others, were all in Assad's custody, until the wave of Arab revolutions, until those protests, and he released them. Do you recognize
Again,
that? Why do you? Why did you not mention this?
Thank you.
We had a senator in New York. He wasn't my favorite politician, but his name was Daniel Moynihan. He was a reactionary on most things, but he had a phrase that I always thought was witty and wise, and that is, you're entitled to your own opinions, but you're not entitled to your own facts. And so my reaction to your comment is that the things that you allege with such confidence to be facts are not facts. And that's one of the problems we are dealing with, that the disinformation campaign has been so all-pervasive. You've got NPR quoting the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, run by a guy from the Muslim Brotherhood, and they're quoting it on NPR as by a reporter in Beirut. So this is what we're up against, that people who think they're in possession of facts aren't. And there's a famous saying by Mark Twain, which I'm fond of quoting, and I think I annoy my friends by quoting it so often, is that it isn't what we don't know that gets us into trouble, it's what we think we know for sure that just ain't so. And I think you ought to reconsider those things and read the book by Tim Anderson, and we can have a discussion after that.
What's the title of that book?
The Dirty War on Syria.
Okay.
And there are journalists, one of whom was with us on our tour, heroic journalists, two women, one a Britisher, one a Canadian, Vanessa Bealey, who has been devoting her life, risking her life, to get the truth out. You can read her work at 21stcenturywire.com. And then there's a Canadian woman by the name of Ava Bartlett, who has been living in Syria, and who's also been fighting the dominant narrative, which is so false. So
name
I don't expect you, I expect...
One specific thing, correct me on one point.
I'm not going to play. I am not.
57.
I am not going
to. We call me a liar.
No, he didn't call you a liar.
No, he didn't.
Misinformation.
You called us. You called us.
Listen, that's. You got to. They gave you their answer. You're not here to. If you want to talk to them, talk to them later.
100% dodge.
We have other people who have questions, including. Thank you. Go on. Johanna?
No, Johanna.
Who else is it? You have anyone else on your
I have Samaya.
Maybe Carl.
Hey, Lisa, before me, I think it's called Yusuf.
Yusuf.
There's a hand in the air.
Okay, Yusuf, go ahead. Here he is. Okay.
I mean, I think talking about left support for empire, we are just being asked, the anti-war movement is being asked to continue the support of Iran and Russian bombing in Syria. Lest someone, you know, who knows what happens. That's exactly what I heard from the front. I mean, it's a ridiculous position for an anti-war groups to have, and I don't think we can have it both ways. I don't think that we could meet with Assad and glorify him when we talk about him being democratically elected, or that Syria is a secular state, or that it has a humane government, or that the people are united behind him. I've lived in Syria, and that is the most bizarre analysis of Syria I have ever heard. So we can't say that, and then at the same time say that we're not taking a position on Assad. I mean, that just doesn't add up. And so what I'm hearing is a cover-up for a dictatorship that has massacred its people until the revolution. Yes, a revolution that gave hopes to millions of people, millions of Syrians who came out peacefully onto the street, the non-violent opposition that was faced with live bullets from the regime, that was jailed, tortured, and put to death. And this is not some fantasy or some mainstream media thing. I have seen them. I have spoken with them. They are my family. They are my friends. Those people exist. You can't just erase them. And I would ask you, where were you in 2011? And whose side were you on when people started going out in the street? And the world conspired against them, because there is an element of truth that it's not just the regime and Russia and Iran that are against the Syrian people. It's also the US and Europe and the Gulf, because nobody wants a successful rebellion. But my challenge to the panel is, like, how dare you then ask the anti-war movement in the United States to line up with this counter-revolution against the Syrian people? A Syrian people who have been at the forefront of suffering under ISIS and other reactionary groups that were born out of what happened in Iraq and then were released from the jails of the regime, as Matt had just said, but it's also people who have been at the forefront of fighting against those ideologies and fighting against against ISIS. So how dare you lump all of the Syrian opposition that is outside the regime areas as being jihadis or terrorists? I mean, that is just blatant Islamophobic racist viewpoint.
So what's the question?
So you had asked about things for the anti-war movement, and I have something to say about that, about how to build an anti-war movement. And I don't think the politics that we have heard today are what are even capable of building an anti-war movement. I think a genuine anti-war movement means that we stand in international solidarity with our Syrian brothers and sisters in their struggle for freedom, while we demand that all governments, all of them, stop the bombing. And it's not that hard to do if we can just stop whitewashing dictatorships. It's not that difficult. And if we accept Syrians as human beings and not deny them their agency.
You have to be willing to listen and have a reasoned dialogue. Go ahead.
I just we keep going back to this issue of Syria and the role of outside countries and outside forces in Syria, and we continually forget what the UN Charter says about regime change. And also when we talk about the Syrian government, no one's glorifying Assad, but we are saying that under the UN Charter, Assad is recognized by the entire world as being a legitimately elected leader of his country, and he is also, and the country is also part, it's legitimately recognized as a country. Therefore, the United Nations Charter should protect it. And if the United Nations Charter should protect it, Article 2 says that there should be no foreign intervention or foreign attempt to invade a sovereign country. Okay, that's one. And number two, Article 52 says that if a country is under attack by outside foreign forces, it can invite those countries in that it wants to help protect it against those outside foreign forces. And that's all we're saying. We're not saying, that's all that I'm saying, that there are international laws that apply here, and that's all we're talking about. And if we,
it's propaganda.
All right, you don't know?
You're not sure?
It's propaganda.
I'm not going to answer. You supported the bombing of Libya, too. You know you did.
Bullshit. All right.
Do you think we have reached the end of this program? It's 8:45. You have to clean up and go, right?
I really think it's ridiculous that people don't listen to each other and be somewhat civil.
Okay, next we have this person, I forget your name. About 5 more minutes.
Maybe make a number of people.
Is it okay if I stand there?
Yeah, you've only got a minute.
Okay, I'll be fast.
We're running out of time.
Okay, I'll be fast. So I want to first preface this by saying I am anti-U.S. imperialism. I'm also against all forms of imperialism. And I think my first question to you is, why didn't you mention the fact that Assad is also employing foreign mercenaries? Hezbollah is a really good example from the very beginning. Second question, which Nate said, and I don't think you responded to, which is that Assad did release hundreds of political prisoners that helped fuel the sectarianism in Syria. And for people who want proof, I heard some people here being like, oh, I didn't know that, I want proof of that. There is proof of that. And in fact, I urge everybody here who hears something and they're like, no, that's a lie, or no, that's not true, if you're a little bit interested in actually knowing the truth, go up and ask for a source. What are you going to lose? Go look at that source. If you don't like it, fine, throw it away. But at least engage with what they're saying, because you're not doing that. Third question. But this is directly to both of you.
About what everybody here is doing.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean everyone, but people know who they are. My third question is about the continuous use of the term the Syrian people. The Syrian people are united behind Assad. The Syrian people are this, the Syrian people are that. So I was a statistics minor at Williams College and at Columbia University here in New York. And I'm going to turn to science because I think that's the one thing everyone here can agree on. And you were in Syria, in Damascus specifically, and maybe neighboring areas for about 6 or 7 days. You probably spoke to maximum, you know, I'm not going to even say how many people you spoke to. There are 23 million Syrians. You said it yourself that right now there are only 11 million people left in Syria. So you spoke to a very small number.
No,
he said
15. There's 11 million displaced. Two-thirds of them live still in Syria. But they're displaced.
All right, I'm sorry.
It doesn't mean they left Syria.
My point is, you spoke to people in Damascus from a very small region. In statistics, basic statistics 101, you cannot conclude that the Syrian people think something based on that. If you really, this is my question. Why is it that you chose to ignore all the Syrian refugees living everywhere in the world? Even those displaced in Syria, why did you choose not to talk to them if you're truly interested in facts and, you know, finding facts? Why is it that you ignored all of them? And I think the last thing I'll say is that, and this is directly to you, I forgot your name.
Joe.
That you, earlier you called someone here annoying for disagreeing with you, and while maybe you disagreed with the way that they did it, I would hope that when you're on this fact-finding mission that you met Syrians who disagreed with you and you were able to engage with them without calling them annoying. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think there was a question in there, but
there were several.
Okay.
There
if you want
several.
To respond, we have about a minute or two left. A couple people, and then
on the question of on the question.
Why don't you ask me a couple? Get on with it.
Yeah, because wrong.
Can I just add a comment?
Quick. No. Questions only.
Raise a question.
Yeah, they've been to Syria recently. Can I ask them a question
Syria,
about?
I've been to many conferences that I can.
Okay, well, give it a try. Quickly.
All right. Basically, my name is Alva Diallo. Basically, I attend conferences at the UN most of the time, and I was one of the youth at the conference in Korea. So my point of view was like to bring peace in this world. Basically, that was my point of view. Because I hear a lot of different people talking about, as they're saying, like, oh, Assad is a bad people, and they're saying Assad is a good person. So I mean, this is one of the things that I was trying to find out as well as I'm coming from the conference in South Korea. So I was basically trying to, because everybody in this world, they think that what they're doing is they're doing the right thing, and the other side doing the bad thing. So I'm glad that they went to there and they find out whatever they have to find out there. And they're too the same their own, so I'm glad to hear both of the sides. So that's all I want to say.
Thank you. I agree. I think keeping the process of talking about our positions and doing it peacefully is the key.
Yeah. So I wanted to, my name is Mitchell. Hi. I just wanted to ask, take a step back from all this, even though everybody wants to get into it, because we're not going to resolve anything here, and we're all irrelevant to that right now. I wanted to ask, going back a ways, what is the underlying, some of the underlying propelling forces? I've been reading a lot about pipelines lately, right? There was a pipeline that was being blocked by the U.S. that Russia wanted to build in the Ukraine, right? And I'm glad you brought in the Ukraine, and the U.S. and Hillary Clinton had a lot to do. Part of the reason for that coup was to block that in the geopolitical. And now I'm just reading today about the pipeline that Russia wants to build that goes across into Turkey. And so Turkey is lying with Russia on some of this. You know, it's all these. And so I was
just
wondering.
Last 15 minutes. Aligning with Russia for the last 15 minutes.
Thanks. Exactly. Before that, it was aligning with NATO and was just a warmonger everywhere. So I wanted to know, how is this shifting alliances? What do they mean in terms of what's happening in Syria right now and how it's being played out?
Thank you for the question.
And then the 2-minute answer is pretty.
Well, the U.S. drive for domination in the Middle East has a number of factors behind it. One is strategic. The U.S. wants to be dominant in a crucial region. Pipelines, oil resources, yeah, that may be, that's one major element, but it's not the only element. There's also the question of Israel and the influence of the Israel lobby on U.S. foreign policy. So these oil, Israel, and empire is my shorthand way of saying these are the main components of what determine the U.S. policy in the Middle East. And the other point is about Russia. Russia's a capitalist country. It's got all the contradictions and problems of a capitalist country. In fact, it's got special problems because of where it was 20, 30 years ago. Putin represents Russian capitalists. He represents oligarchs. It happens that right now, objectively, he's playing and what you might call an anti-hegemonic role. He's opposing the dominant global power, namely the United States, and the Russian forces are in Syria at the request of the government. And this answers the question of the young woman over here. What's the difference between Syrian government's outside supporters and this outside jihadis that the U.S. And Saudi Arabia have organized? The answer is, Syrian government is a sovereign government and has a right to pick its own allies, and therefore they have a different status and should have a different status in our eyes as well as small d Democrats. If we are small d Democrats, we oppose empire. That's the basic position. And there are people in here who have bought into this Assad demonization almost to a psychotic level, I have to say. Almost to a psychotic level. And they can't see anything else but that. It's tragic, but it exists.
Let me add, beyond our demons tonight.
I want to add one thing about pipeline, okay, and that is that there's an article that was written by Robert Kennedy Jr. About how this is a pipeline war, and he wrote it many years ago, and he goes back through history to show how this is about pipeline. And somebody else recently said it's not about pipeline, it's something else, but they're all, you know, around some of the same issues of resources and control over resources. So as this young woman suggested, there's a source out there if you want to hear also more about what we're saying here in the front. You know, Robert F. Kennedy's article it's a long one, but it's very well analyzed and reasoned. So I would just recommend that. And the Qatar, there's a Qatari pipeline that I've heard that I believe he writes about, which the Syrian government said no to, and that's also, you know, potentially part of the friction between the Syria and what's called the petrodollar, and the Gulf War states with interests over oil and petrodollars. So that's what I would add to the discussion.
We're going to have to put the chairs back and rearrange the furniture here before 9 o'clock. If you need to talk to them, they might be here for a minute or two. And I don't know if they. Do you have any more patients to talk to anybody? Yeah.